Good morning. How are y'all this morning? Good. Good. I've got a few announcements this morning, and then I want to talk to you a little bit about the youth, mostly just because I want to make you aware of some things that you may not be aware of as a church. So with our youth program, some cool things going on there. So let me first hit your bulletin. I'll just call out a few of the things on here. I know you can read, so I won't dive in too deep. In the hallway, you might have walked by some tables if you came in from this way. For the mega sports camp. So we talked about that a couple weeks ago. That's a kind of a new spin on VBS, and we need volunteers for that. And so if you are interested at all, or if you just are looking for a spot to serve, we'd love to have you join us to host the first mega sports camp. Dates and times are in here. So the other thing is make sure you have Family Life Night on your calendar, which is on the 25th, so coming up here pretty quick. Make sure you get that on your calendar. It's always a potluck and a business meeting, so make sure you get that on the calendar. And then the last thing I would hit on here is this Dodge Dine and or DCA Dine and Dodge. I can read for a cause. That's a good event coming up, and we need more teams for that. So if you want to read about that, it's on the last page of your bulletin there. Now, I want to talk to you really quickly, ask Michael for just a few minutes to let you guys know as a church what you're doing to support our youth group. And so in the absence of a youth pastor, there's six volunteers who have stepped up, actually more than that, who have stepped up and are working with our youth weekly and having a blast doing it. So as we thought about how do we go about having a fun program, but also one that's we don't want it to be babysitters. We want it to be engaging, and we wanted our youth to really get involved. And so what we came up with was a point system, and the point system rewards kids, our youth. It rewards them for doing things that we should all be doing anyway. So attendance matters, carrying a Bible matters, service projects are rewarded. And so we just have a whole list of things that we reward points for or award points for. And so we started doing that in January when we opened back up as soon as we could following COVID. And so it's been kind of rigorous. I won't say it's easy stuff. We are working through every week we've been working through a book called Fundamentals of Our Faith, and we're talking about everything starting from the Bible and creation and who God is and who Jesus is. And this week we're going to be in who the Holy Spirit is. And it's pretty in-depth. We get into the names of God. We get into the attributes of God. We've got into the names of Jesus and the person of Jesus and what does Jesus do. And we're about to dive into the Holy Spirit, and that'll take us a few weeks to get through that. And it's pretty rigorous. We're not asking, like, they can't sit there and just answer Jesus like a Sunday school lesson. And I don't mean that's how our Sunday school lessons go, but you know what I mean. It's not a Sunday school answer. They have to really engage, and it's pretty rigorous. And so we're really proud of the kids who took serious our point system and have engaged in our program. And so we came to the finance committee, and we just said, hey, if we have our youth engaging in this program, can we reward them with a discipleship trip? And we want to do it quarterly. And of course they said, yeah, you have a budget. And so we did our first trip in April, and we took the top 12. And I want to tell you, these kids grabbed hold of this program, and we had some of our youth that got 70% of the points that we offered. And so that's pretty amazing. And then as we went down the ladder, we had a good gap. But the thing we struggled with was, how do we take just the top 12 when we've got 15 that are just really knocking it out of the park? But we also want to teach we want to take the people who are really earning their way. And God worked it all out. So we had the top 15, and we had three that had prior commitments that could not make it. And so God worked it out. And actually, we came out after it was all done. We ended up taking 10 kids. And I want y'all to, what I want you to know is that we took this trip. It was a very focused trip. We were very intentional on who sets where and what conversations do we have. How do we start these conversations? But we took these four banners here, connect, grow, serve, share, and we put a perseverance theme. So every one of these kids on here, as we built relationship, we're pretty confident in their faith. We know that they're Christians. And what we wanted them to know as we spent time with them. So traveling down, we talked about, you know, our connection and how do we persevere in our connection with the church. And then we talked about growth and how do we walk all our days out. How do we grow? How do we persevere with Christ as we grow as Christians? And so we just tied all of that together, and we had some awesome conversations, but it was really a discipleship trip. What we want these young people to know is that they're really our little brothers and our little sisters in Christ. And this trip was about rewarding them, but it was also about making sure that they understand that we're to persevere as Christians. And guarantee you, as a Christian, everybody in here would say, it's not guaranteed easy. And so what we want is to arm them. We want to equip them so that they are ready to walk out into a world someday that's not going to be easy, and we want them to persevere with their faith. And so I want to just recognize these kids this morning that made it. I'm going to recognize the ones who couldn't make it because they also worked really hard, but I'm not going to ask them to stand up. What I want you to do, we have throughout the first quarter, we had 48 kids that showed up off and on, and only a dozen qualified. So it's pretty intense competition. And all I would ask you to do is, as you see these kiddos, just encourage them. A couple of these names were recently baptized, and some of them are about to be baptized. And so God is moving in our youth. There's some great things going on. Y'all are part of it, and we thank you for your support, and we also covet your prayers as we continue to work in the youth group. So on our first trip, we went to Dallas. We did some fun things. We did a ninja gym. We did Top Golf. We went to a Rangers game. And we had a lot of good meals together and a lot of time to have good discussions. And in that trip was Addison Ramirez, who y'all saw get baptized on Easter, Brett Haston, Audra Job, Claire Wilcox. Andrew Burgeon made it, but he had a prior commitment, so did Cole and Aaron Cox, all those part of an FFA team that was competing, and they were part of a team, and they didn't want to let their team down, and that they were actually on that team first. And so they had to step out, but that opened the way for some others. There was also Owen Powell, there was Jaden Cross, Weatherby Saavedra, Kate Wilcox, Tripp Trimble, and Ashton Knight. So all of those kids, as y'all see them, I'm just going to tell you, they're working hard, they're learning, they're growing. Encourage them where you can. And thank you so much for supporting that first trip that we took for a discipleship trip for our youth. So with that, I'm going to wrap up the announcements. Just wanted you to know about that. And we'll pray and get started here. So, Father, we love you. Thank you for this time together as a church, as your people. Lord, I pray that this morning as we sing that we glorify you. And I pray that as we hear your word, that it changes our hearts. Lord, I pray that in Foundations this morning, as we were challenged to think about our role in holding the rope for our missionaries, that you would just use that and talk to our hearts there too. Father, help us to be so serious about what we do here, for you're the first thing in our life. You're the thing that matters in our life. And we love you, and we give you all the glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Man, thank you, Gideon, so much for that update. It is so good to see that God is moving in our midst, that he is working, that we're seeing people coming to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, that our baptismal waters are being stirred, and we want to see that continue to take place in this church. We have come together this morning in the name of Jesus Christ, and we enter into his presence through the blood of Jesus. We enter into the presence of God through the blood of Jesus Christ, and we want to exalt him today. And just as we sing these songs this morning, we're just declaring the truth of our God, of who he is and how he meets us where we're at. So however you feel led today, let's praise our God.
Great are you, Lord, mighty in strength. You are faithful, and you will never be. We will praise you all of our days. It's for your glory we offer everything. Raise your hands, holy nations, shout. Lord knows time. We want the world to know. We will trust you when you call our name. When you lead us, we'll follow all the way. Raise your hands, all you nations. Shout to God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. We will praise you together.
Singing hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How awesome is the Lord Most High.
You know, life's not easy, right? Can anyone attest to that right now? Anybody? God is seated on the throne, and he's working. We don't always see it. Sometimes we feel like, God, where are you? But he sees us. He knows us. We're in his hand. And we just have to continue to trust that he's going to see things through in his time. And that's kind of what the remainder of our worship set is this morning. And we just sang about the awesomeness of our God. And that word is so overused today, right? Okay, grandparents, have you ever heard your kids say, oh, that's awesome? Am I right? Come on, I see some laughter out there, right? They get a new Barbie doll, right? Or a little G.I. Joe guy, and they're playing, oh, that's awesome. Does that truly inspire awe? But when we consider the greatness, the majesty, the sovereignty, the power, the glory, the grace, the love, and the peace, and words that we can't even use to describe our God, that's awesome. That's awesome. And that creator of the universe would desire a relationship with us. And even knowing that we would disobey him, would surrender his son, would still go ahead and create us anyways and prepare to surrender his son for us. Folks, that's awesome. Let's keep praising him this morning. Thank you.
Here we go.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me.
After me.
Sing a little louder.
Sing it out.
Sing a little louder. 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 Sing a little louder.
Everybody sing.
Sing a little louder in the presence of my enemies. Sing a little louder, louder than the unbelief. Sing a little louder. My weapon is a melody. Sing a little louder.
I raise a
walking around these walls. I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last, your word will come to pass, my heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough, keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again.
Just declare this truth.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness.
This is just a reminder to us that our God never leaves us. He never forsakes us.
I've seen you move. You move the mountains. And I believe. I see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. And I believe. I'll see you do it again. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet.
Spirit, help us to never forget, Lord, that you are with us, that you are fighting our battles for us. God, that you love us with an unfailing love, that you sent your Son to die for us. God, you've revealed yourself to us in the power of your word, which we're going to begin studying here right now. And we're just praying, Lord, that you will move in our midst today. As only you can, move in each and every individual heart today, revealing to us, God, the ways that we need to change to be more like Jesus. We pray these things in his name. Everyone said, amen.
Yeah, great theme this morning. As we think about our perseverance, that's what Gideon was talking about with the students and what they've been impressing upon them, and Hugh leading us through those thoughts today was really important, because it has been a tough time, and really I think it always will be as we endeavor to follow Christ, and perseverance and remembering those truths is so important. And then if you're keeping score, this will be our 13th sermon in the book of Colossians, and we made it through 2.5 chapters, and so we're going to land the plane someday, but we'll just keep going through one at a time, these passages in Colossians. And one of the things, you guys who come all the time know that I enjoy taking books of the Bible and just walking through them, learning everything that we can about it, for a couple of reasons. One is we need to know the whole Word of God. We need to know, what the whole Bible says about the things that we talk about. And secondly, it forces me to talk about topics that I might otherwise skip. Pastors have favorite things they like to talk about, and we can just zero in on those things. But when you walk through entire books, you have to talk about everything. And so we'll do that. And then thirdly, you know that I'm not just picking on you. I'm not just picking a passage because I think that's what you need to hear. I'm basically just taking them one at a time. And if it comes up to a passage that you really need to hear, then we'll just trust the Lord that he's put you here for that week. And because today we're going to talk about wives submitting to your husbands. And so what I did is I just wrote down 37 ways that I think wives could do a much better job of submitting to their husbands. I'm just teasing. That would not be good for me. Or for you, because the passage is way bigger than that. But, the Bible has talked about particular order of things. And so just to kind of review where we've been talking about the supremacy of Jesus. The book of Colossians runs on kind of two rails. That Jesus is supreme, that he's preeminent, that he's all that you need. You've got Jesus in the whole world. You don't have anything more than the person who has only Jesus. He is supreme above all things. He is our hope. He is our purpose. He is our comfort. He's everything. And the more you connect to Jesus, just the more your life will become full and whole. And secondly, maturing in Christ. Paul said in the very first, it's his desire that everyone, everywhere, matures and grows up into Christ. And I think we have to realize, and hopefully we can admit to ourselves, that much of our problems as human beings, even in churches, and churches bickering and fighting, and churches whatever, it's because people are immature. You're not growing up in Christ. And as we grow up in Christ, things that used to be a big deal really don't become a big deal anymore. And we focus on the major things. And so Paul says, grow up into Christ. And we've been talking about that a lot. And so he said that, I got a quote here. Oh, yeah. And so what we're seeing here is something that Paul does pretty much through all his letters. He doesn't really give us any commands until he gives us the doctrine and the theology of why that matters. And so we need to to know the supremacy of Christ. We need to grow up in him. And then we begin to see how we do that. How do we live out those theologies and those doctrines in our lives? The way I said it last week is that you have to know the indicatives, the truths, before you talk about the imperatives, which are the commands. And we do see Paul do that. So the first two chapters are really primarily the indicatives. Who is Christ? And why is he important? Why is he supreme? Why is he worth your time? Why is he worth all of your attention and devotion? And then now as you move into chapter 3, he moves into, now what? If Christ is these things, how should we respond? If Christ is supreme, how should we follow him and live that out? And Eugene Peterson says it this way. All of the redemptive activity of God has been focused on us. He's talking about the church. We are not ourselves by ourselves. We are men and women in Christ. Only as we realize that and reflect it, is it safe to talk about how we should then conduct our lives. And so really it's not fair to talk about what we ought to do in Christ until we learn who we are in Christ. And we've done that. So we've talked about the supremacy of Christ. Now we're going to talk about these commands. And in last week we started looking at conduct as response to our new identity in Christ. That, you know, part of the supremacy of Christ and his salvation in this is that we are united with Christ. We talked about that for several weeks, that what's true of Christ now is true of us when we have our faith in him. And we should live out this new identity. And we live it out by putting away or putting to death certain things, sexual immorality, impurity, evil passions, desires, greed, anger, wrath, malice, abuse of speech, and lying. All those things need to be put to death. We need to actively and consciously just get those things out of our life. And we do that because we have been united with Christ. And I argued pretty heavily, and I think the text points it, that these things are really terrible because they're divisive. The things that God tells us to put out of our life are those things that destroy relationships or the things that keep us from living in harmony with one another. I talked about in our foundations class this morning about really the biblical ethic is God is creating a people to cover the whole earth, a people who love him and love one another. And these sinful things that God tells us to put away are always things that tear up relationships and divide people. In this context, is what destroys the unity of churches. That we need to put these things away so we can unify it as a church. It really had a church context to it. So we got to get rid of those things that destroy harmony and relationships, and primarily in the church. But then the way that we do that is we don't only focus on what we put to death, but we also focus on what we're supposed to put on: compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, bearing with one another, and forgiving each other. You know, those things are all critical to living in relationship with one another. You're not going to live in harmony with any human being on the earth if you don't know how to be compassionate and kind and forgiving, long-suffering, all of those things that are important and represent our new life in Christ. And so today we are going to move into this section of, now that he's talked about generally how this applies to our church family, more specifically, how does this apply to the most close relationships in our lives, our marriages, our lives with our kids, and our life with our coworkers and things like that. And we'll take those over the next few weeks one at a time. And so today we're going to look at the marriage relationship. How does our unity with Christ affect our marriage? How does this new identity in Christ help us to relate better with our spouse? How is it when we put away these evil passions and this selfishness and we put on kindness and goodness and forgiveness? How does that foster better marriages? And that's what we're going to talk about. So if you will, stand with me as we honor the reading of God's word. And I'm just going to read two verses in Colossians chapter 3, verses 18 and 19. Colossians 3, 18 and 19. These will be on the screen if you haven't brought your Bible. It says, "Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them." Let me pray. Father, as we just look at these two verses, let us not just think that their number represents the importance, because that's not true. We know that there's nothing more important than marriage and relationship between husband and wives and how that does set the tone for all of our society. And Father, you, from the beginning, have ordained husbands and wives to live together in a certain way. And help us to trust your word, that when we obey, when we live out your ethic, that lives actually go better, and that things are more fulfilling and whole and complete. And so, Father, we do pray that you help bless the reading of your word and help us to understand it better than we have in the past. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right. place. Please be seated there. So another way to kind of talk about everything I just said a moment ago is that one of the things that Paul's doing right now, and we see it all the way through his letters, is that the way that we relate to God should affect the way that we relate to one another. That should be a natural consequence as we get closer to God and worship God and devote ourselves to God. It should, you know, begin to trickle out into our relationships. And so there are passages like this through the Bible that are called in German, Hausstaffen. If you want to know what we talk about in seminary, you learn German words like Hausstaffen. And it's coined by Martin Luther, the great reformer in the 16th century. And it literally just translates into house table. But the way that the theologians talk about it, there's household codes. That there's these household codes given to us in many passages that help us to understand really how has God ordained the order and the function of the household. How are people within a certain household able to advance and to flourish? And we talked about this a lot last fall when we were going through our series in Genesis. We talked about how these household codes or these ways that God has created us to live together come out of the creative order. That when God was creating the world, he built into his world certain laws and certain things that if we follow them, we're going to be much more healthy and we're going to be much more full. And the thing that we learned in Genesis is that God has ordained the family to be the vehicle through which he is going to accomplish his purposes. We'll talk about it kind of at the end, but right now, just to review in Genesis, remember that God created the earth and all that's in it. And we talked about spaces, how God created spaces, then he filled the spaces, and then ultimately he created human beings in a very particular and special role to be his representatives to the earth. That God had created man in his own image, and he had given him work to do. And that man was called to subdue the whole earth, to bring it under the submission of God's loving reign and rule, and he was to bring all of the earth into subjection to God's authority, and then he created Eve to be his helper. It was too big of a job for him to do it himself, that these mandate that God had given Adam needed help. So he created Eve to be his helper. And we read that in Genesis chapter 2, verse 24. It says, therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. So in other words, in this process of one man being joined together with one woman, they're to work together in harmony and in balance to fulfill the work that God had given them to do, to subdue the old earth, to bring the whole earth under subjection of God's rule and reign, and ultimately to extend the beauty of the garden to the whole world. And we do it as image bearers who reflect the glory of God in the way that we relate to one another. Of course, we read the whole story last year, and you probably remember it as well, is that Adam and Eve sinned, and they rebelled against God's creative order. They rebelled against the way that God had established order in his creation, where man and woman would live together in harmony under God's authority, under his loving reign and rule. And so we know they were banished from the garden. And the consequences of that sin is that the harmony and the balance that once existed in this marriage relationship was shattered. And so God had ordered marriage to live in a certain way, but because of sin, it was shattered. And so whenever we read these passages, and we see that they might be foreign or they might be contrary to how we understand how relationships should work together, you know, this idea of wives submitting, you know, doesn't really ring very popular in our culture, but we have to understand that before sin, it worked well. It was perfect. It was balanced. There was harmony. There was nothing wrong with it. And it was beautiful, and it accomplished what God wanted to accomplish. But we destroyed that with our sin. And so the point that Paul has been making is that Christ has come to redeem the creative order. Everything that was destroyed or broken apart or distorted because of our sin, Jesus has come to bring back together. This ideal that God built into his creation that was shattered by sin, Jesus has come to rebuild. Jesus hasn't come to do something different or other than God's original intention. Jesus has come to restore and to rebuild God's original intention. In fact, we've talked many times about how Ephesians and Colossians are almost companion books, that they are really similar. They're written at the same time, addressing the same issues. And so they really do interpret one another. And one way to understand Colossians is to read Ephesians and vice versa. If you want to know more about Ephesians, read Colossians. They fit together. And this is how Paul writes this in the beginning of Ephesians. He says, in him, that's Christ, this is Ephesians 1, verse 7, In him, being Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan. Here it is. So the mystery of God's will is a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. When I taught through Ephesians several years ago, a term I got from N.T. Wright, he's a British scholar, is cosmic reconciliation, that Christ has come to reconcile all things in the cosmos. That's the universe. That all things are being brought back together. Everything that has been blown apart because of sin and everything that's been distorted because of sin, Christ has come to bring back together. And so in this marriage relationship that at one time lived in perfect harmony with wives submitting to husbands and husbands taking the lead, and it worked in balance and harmony, now it's been destroyed, and Jesus has come to bring that back together, because we know that that's one of the examples of that. Ephesians 1, Christ is bringing things all back together. What are we reading in Ephesians 5? Husband and wives coming back together under the authority of Christ. So Christ has come to redeem everything that has been broken in the fall, including the concept of biblical marriage. He's helping us as we unite with Christ. Again, we're flowing out of that in Colossians, that we're united to Christ in his death, in his resurrection. We've died to our old selfish, pitiful ways. Now we've been raised to live according to Christ and his ways. We're united with him. And one of the things that our new identity in Christ can accomplish for us is a better union with our spouse. That the tension and the conflict that has been brought about by the fall has been, we have now the capacity to overcome that through our union with Christ. And so the harmony and balance that was destroyed can be recreated in Jesus Christ. The relationships that are tough, and marriage is tough, and we have to understand that every marriage has seasons of difficulty, and there's times of conflict, and there's always, you know, confusion, and there's always maybe tension, and there's, I mean, it's a tough deal for two people who are sinful and selfish to come together and live in harmony and balance. But as we submit our lives more and more to our new identity in Christ, and the more we embrace and live out our new identity that is ours in Christ, we have this new capacity to live out our lives differently, and we can bring balance and harmony back to our marriage relationship. That's the goal. Again, because God has established marriage to be the vehicle through which he has accomplished his purposes on the earth, and so it's important. It's important that we understand how we're supposed to live together in this balance and harmony. And so, you know, the last few passages kind of inform us how we get that done. Again, I'm really trying to keep this passage in context with where we've been in Colossians, where he says at the beginning of chapter 3 that we need to set our minds and our hearts on the things that are above and not on the things that are on earth. And so if we want to redeem and restore this harmony and balance that should exist in our marriages, we need to take our eyes off of all of the worldly influences that talk about how husband and wife should work together, and we focus our hearts and minds on the things of heaven and how has God created us and what is our life in Christ like. And so he's telling us we redeem marriage by, you know, seeking the things of heaven and not on earth. And we no longer have this short-sighted view of marriage, thinking it's only about me and my fulfillment and my happiness. That's not at all. We'll talk about that more in a minute. And also, we have to put off those old things. Those old things that he talked about last week, about this immorality and passions and evil desires. Or we talked about how said that selfishness that's in us. What is that list of sins that we talked about last week? I said, how do they, you know, how do we talk about them as a group? And it's all about just selfish, gimme, I want mine, I've got this itch, and I better scratch it, and you better not stand in the way of me getting what I want. You know, that's the heart of sin. And if we're going to live together in a perfect marriage, we can't do that. We can't have that selfish, give me what I want, and you better serve me attitude. It can't be, you're here for me, and you better make it right. We have to put that to death. And then we have to put on this other side that comes from Christ of compassion and kindness and humility and gentleness and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving each other. I mean, I've said this so many times that you cannot live in the same household with another human being unless you learn how to be forgiving, because we are going to hurt each other. We're going to let each other down, and we can't do it if we're not kind and patient and gentle. And I've seen people, and I'm guilty of this as well. I mean, we're just much more kind to the stranger at the grocery store than we are to our wives many times. But we need to be kind, and we need to be gentle, and we need to be compassionate There may not be a better list of characteristics and qualities that are necessary to make, you know, every relationship work, especially the relationship of marriage. And I think those are something that we should really spend some time focusing on, putting off those selfish things and putting on the selfless things that we see in Christ Jesus. So let's go from the big picture, and now let's go back to the smaller picture. Let's turn our attention to these specific instructions that Paul gives us to help restore that balance and that harmony that should exist in every marriage. I'll just read it again, Colossians 3, 18 and 19. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord. And husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. But another second before we get into these specific instructions or these roles that God has given us, I want to talk about really this overarching idea that we see communicated all through these house staffing or these household passages. And the thing that we see is mutuality. We see equality. And I think that's the thing that we forget whenever we read, like, wives submit and husbands love. We don't see the mutuality or the equality that's there, but they are there. And we have to understand that in this central human relationship, there's a husband and a wife who are created with different strengths and different perspectives, but they're called together, they're called to come together in unity and harmony for this common good. And the churchy word is complementarianism. And I'm just kind of teaching you of things right now, is that, as you know, that word was only coined about 35 years ago. John Piper and Wayne Grudem actually coined the word. I learned that recently. But complementarianism is, you know, two people coming together to complement one another. And there should be mutuality of complementing one another. People with different strengths and perspectives, as I said, and coming together to accomplish a common purpose is you know, that each is distinct, but they come together to make a unique whole. And in this complementary relationship, the husband and wife are given distinct roles based upon God's creative idea. And the thing that we have to realize is these differing roles in one way or another never talk about value or dignity that belongs to each person. So we talk about this mutuality of roles. When we talk about people with different strengths and passions and perspectives coming together, there's never any speak about someone being less dignified or less valuable than the other. You know, a true complementarian position does believe that the Bible emphatically declares that both men and women are image bearers created in the image of God. I mean, we are both equally an image bearer created in the image of God. Secondly, both men and women have equal access to salvation through Christ alone, through faith. The wife is not saved through her husband. She has an opportunity to equal access to God through Jesus Christ. Both receive spiritual gifts from the Holy Spirit, with both men and women receiving the whole array of the gifts. Some of the gifts aren't reserved only for men, and some of the gifts aren't only reserved for women. Each man and woman receive the full complement of the spiritual gifts. That means that women have the same gifts as men. And I think that probably in history, no other document besides the Bible elevates the role of women and appreciates their equality and dignity more than the Bible. And I think we have to understand that going in, anytime we talk about the differing roles that God gives each to the genders. But in God's creative design, men and women, we have to admit, are created different. I don't know if I have to really argue that point very long, that boys are different than girls. I've said this before, that probably the primary struggle that Annie and I have had in my marriage is that she's a girl. And she would say that the primary struggle is that I'm a boy. And we just see the world differently. We don't have to argue with that. I've had a boy first, and man, we thought we had kids figured out, and here comes this girl, and she was radically different out of the womb. I mean, there was just nothing in common between the boy and the girl. And so to kind of illustrate this point, I did do some research on the internet about what are some of the differences just between boys and girls. One, it says men and women don't see in the same way. And it goes, and this is research, it says that from the very start of light hitting the retina, the information arriving in the brain is different in males and females. Now, the article said that the male retina is thicker and the female retina is thinner. And what that does is it causes males to track movement, and it causes women to track texture and color better. I think that's true. You know, men, their eyes are created to track movement, because where are you supposed to be? You're the hunter-gatherer. What's the deer running across? And I've been amazed to be driving down the road with a guy, and he says, man, there's a deer 5,000 yards that way moving across the horizon. I'm like, I don't see it. But, man, he sees it. He's tracking that movement. And he's saying, man, how beautiful that flower is over there. Right? There's differences. Even how we see things. Women see texture and color where men see movements. It talks about babies in the crib, that girl babies generally are attracted to smiling faces, or again, where boys are generally attracted to movement. And so a girl wants to see the mom's face over the crib, and she'll fixate on that, where the boy is fixating on a mural that's spinning around. Hundreds of babies were studied in that. Boys and girls like to draw different things. Most girls prefer drawing people, animals, and plants arranged symmetrically and facing the viewer, where boys most draw action scenes with dynamic movement. Here's one, and this is scientifically proven. It's on the internet, so it can't be wrong, right? Females actually do hear better than males. That in your brain, your center for language and hearing, women have 11% more neurons than men. So he's not just ignoring you. He can't hear you. You hear much better than he does, right? And that's what I tell Annie. She says, I told you. I said, but was I looking at you when you told me, right? I have only 89% of your neurons, babe. I just learned that this week. And so I'm not trying to ignore you, but it's true. Music affects women and men differently. Where did that one go? Premature baby girls who received music therapy had fewer complications. They grew faster and were able to be discharged earlier than the ones that did not. And there was no effect on premature boys who were listening to music. Again, I got 12 more, and I'm not going to go through those. I just wanted to kind of have a little bit of fun and say, yes, man is different than woman. Husbands, you are created different than your spouse, your wife. But God did that on purpose, that he did that with intention. He did that because that's what he wanted in his creation, two separate things coming together for a common good, complementing one another. And here's a really great reality is I know this to be true, that if it was not for Annie, my household would be a wreck, that there would be disaster everywhere. We wouldn't eat vegetables. We wouldn't be clean. I mean, there's all kinds of things that would not happen if Annie wasn't in my household. I wouldn't be nearly the preacher I am if she wasn't with me, complimenting, helping me. She sees things differently than me, and she'll tell me, and she'll give me her perspective. And many of the good things that I write into my sermon are for her telling me from a woman's perspective differently, things that she sees differently than me when she's reading this passage. And so there are differences in the way men and women, here's the truth too, if it was only Annie, our house would be a mess. Boys and girls need their daddy. And I bring value that she doesn't bring. And I don't want to just, you know, diminish one role over the other. They're both necessary and they're both different, and that's a good thing. So let's quit being mad at each other because we're not the same, because we don't think the same, because we don't see things the same way. God did that on purpose. We'll talk about why in a few more minutes, but we have to understand that we are created differently to complement one another, to accomplish the purposes of God. John MacArthur writes, the essence, the spiritual quality, and the position before God of both husband and wife are the same. But in the family, for the sake of function, the woman is to take the place of submission to the leadership of the man. So for the sake of function, for the sake of efficiency, for the sake of fruitfulness, God had to establish authoritarian structures. I've talked about that before as well. We see authority structures in every area of life, but God has also created an authority structure in the marriage, not because one is less valuable or dignified than the other, not because one is less gifted than the other, but God, through his providence and through his wisdom, has said one needs to submit to the other for the sake of the function and the fruitfulness of the church. So let's talk about these two. We'll talk about the woman first, the wife first, because that's how Paul did it. I don't think there's really any, well, I do think there's a reason why he did it this way, but it's not because of value or dignity. He says, wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord. And so I was going to talk about it, give you a few observations, and at the end I want to tie them both together. So we'll talk about the wives first, the men together, or separately, and then both of them together at the end. So what are the observations about this passage, wives, submit to your husbands as fitting to the Lord? One, wives are only to submit to their husbands. We're thinking, wives are only called to submit to their husbands. This doesn't mean that women are supposed to submit to every man that they encounter. God hasn't created a subclass or a second-class citizen that's subservient to every male that's on the planet. My wife is not called to submit to any one of you guys. She's not called to submit to me, right? Because she has equal value in gifting and dignity. And in our relationship, raising our children, accomplishing the purpose of God, God has called me to be the leader and her to submit to me, but she's not called to submit to anyone else. No woman has to defer to a man just because he's a man. Now, there are authority structures, and so you have a boss. If you're a woman, have a boss that's a man, of course you need to submit to him. And the same thing, man, if you have a boss as a woman, you submit to her as well because there's a different authority structure in that particular place in your life. But in the marriage relationship, a woman only has to submit to her husband, and she's not called to submit to every other man on the planet. Secondly, the word submit here in this context definitely demonstrates a volunteer nature. And what I mean by that is, in these household codes, we see it in Colossians, we see it in Ephesians, we see it in 1 Peter, we see it in 1 Corinthians. There's several of these Hausdorffian passages that talk about household codes. And one thing that you'll notice is there's a consistency. Women are called to submit to their husbands, but when you go down the rest of them, children obey their parents, and servants obey their masters. In every other social circle, the one who has the inferior role obeys. But in marriage, the word is submit. And I think they did that on purpose. I think that there is a difference in the way that the wife submits to her husband versus the way a child obeys the parent or a worker obeys the boss. And that word submit, we learned it pretty heavily when we were going through this household code. And I keep saying code, but it's code, not cold. Hupotasso, you might remember that in 1 Peter. When I talked about wives submitting to your husbands and servants submitting to your masters. It's the word hupotasso, and it literally means place yourself under. Or line yourself up under. It's a compound word in the Greek that you place yourself under. And so what it's telling us here, it has to be something a person does freely and voluntarily. In other words, no one can force someone else to hupotasso. I can't force you to hupotasso because the minute I force you to do it is the minute it's no longer a hupotasso, it's something else. It's oppression or other things like that. So this is a voluntarily submission for the sake of order in the household, because if it's forced, it's something else. And another thing we have to understand is, men, nowhere in the Bible is the husband commanded to force your wife to submit to you. You can't force her to do this. This is not something that you can put onto her. She either does it voluntarily or it doesn't happen at all. And you have to live with that. And so it's something that's voluntary in nature because of the nature of the word that Paul uses in contrast to the other social relationships. It happens freely or it doesn't happen at all. And thirdly, which leads me to kind of feeds into the next one, is, it says, wives, submit to your husbands, hupotasso, to your husbands, voluntarily line yourself up under him. Why? As is fitting to the Lord. The thing that Paul is saying here is that the wife submits herself to her husband as an act of worship and an act of faith. You do this as unto the Lord. You do this because you're worshiping the Lord, that you are seeing the beauty and the wisdom and the providence of God and how he has created society to work, and you voluntarily submit to your husband in obedience to your King and your Lord. So don't place yourself under the leadership of your husband because he's worth it. If that was the case, if you waited until your husband was worth it, then you never would. I know that I'm not always deserving of being followed and being submitted to. It's not about me being worth it. It's about Jesus being worth it. And so you submit as an act of worship and an act of faith, that God has instilled certain principles into his creation for reasons that he only knows. Why did he choose the man to be the leader and the woman to submit to his leadership? We don't know. God hasn't told us. He hasn't said because men are better. He never said that. He said men are sinful in heart and they need Jesus. But in his providence, he has called men to lead and women to submit. And so we trust him. We have to at some point take this step of faith that I'm going to trust the Lord and do what he has asked me to do, regardless of how much sense it makes on the earth, is that we do it as an act of worship and an act of faith. And we see this illustrated pretty clearly when Peter is talking about his household code in 1 Peter 3. 1 Peter 3, starting in verse 5, says, "For this is how the holy women who hoped in God," that's the part, "here's how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves by submitting to their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. And you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening." The key part there is the holy women who hoped in God. So the only reason for any of us, men or women, to obey the teachings of Scripture is because we're hoping in God. Our hope is in God, that He knows what He's doing, that He is working things out. He is working on our behalf. He is completing what He started in us, that He has a cosmic plan, a universal plan beyond our understanding, and He has asked us to do certain things. So the only reason why I would obey anything in the Scriptures, and the only reason why Annie would obey submitting to me, is because she trusts and her hope is in the Lord. And so I would basically say the degree, wives, that you submit to your husbands is exactly proportional to the degree that you trust the Lord. If you trust the Lord, He's on your side. He's looking out for you. He hears you, and He hears your cries, and He's working things out in you, then you will obey and begin to submit to your husband. But if you do not trust the Lord, you're probably having trouble submitting to your husband and following these particular ideas. And let me say one more thing before we move into husbands, because it's important. Trusting the Lord doesn't mean that you endure abuse or oppression. Pastors, rightly so, right now are being being tarred and feathered because they have not stood up for women. Basically, a woman's getting abused, and they're saying, "You need to go back and submit. That's wrong. That is evil." Trusting the Lord doesn't mean you stay in an abusive environment. We're going to talk about the men's responsibility in the first part is to keep your wife safe. And if that's not happening, please get out. Hear me now. Get out. Get out. Get out if you're not safe. Please. And we will support you. We will work for reconciliation. But get out if you're not safe. Because submitting to your husband does not mean that you become subservient to his abuse. Okay, we'll move on. Let's look at what the Bible says about husbands. The thing that's unique about these household codes that are in the Scriptures is not that they're unique. One of the things that we understand looking at history is that there's all kinds of different cultural household codes. There's all kinds of philosophers, Aristotle, Plato, who write household codes about how the relationship would work. And it's not very unique for these secular household codes to call for women to submit. That's been universally something that's been called upon all through history. But what is unique, what is different about the Scriptures, is that it talks to the husband. No other code talks to the husband, but the Bible talks to the husband and says, you've got a responsibility to live up to yourself. And that's what's unique about it. And it's extremely rare. I was listening to G.K. Beale talking about this. He's a world-renowned scholar. He says it's radical. It's radical for any household code to have any responsibility given to the husband. It's usually only to the woman. And so this is big. And again, as I said a moment ago, the Bible goes further than any other document in history to protect and lift up the dignity and value of women, because it's putting a huge responsibility on the man. And let's talk about that. And let's unpack it in the time that we have left. I'm going to go a little long, sorry. And let's look at all three passages that describe the husband's role in marriage. We read this one, "Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them." We're also very familiar with Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 27. "Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish." In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7, it says, "Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since you are both heirs of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered." The reason why I included all three passages is because the Bible actually has quite a lot more to say to men than it does to women. It's calling women to submit to her husband, but in order to bring about that mutuality and to bring about that equal dignity between men and women, he puts a lot of boundaries onto men not to abuse the authority that he's given you. He's calling you out to be a leader. He's calling you out to be someone who loves and protects and serves his wife. And again, this was radical. This is unique. No other philosopher in history has said men need to be careful to be the kind of guy that your woman would want to submit to. If you want her to submit to you, then you need to step up and be who it is that you've called to be. And I will say very clearly right now, and you guys who are here today probably don't, this doesn't apply to you, but everyone, men, if we don't get it together, we're not going to lead our culture into any healing or any sense of restoration or reconciliation. I can't remember who said it, Doug Wilson or Dan Patrick said, as men go, so goes society. And I will say, as men go, so goes the church. As men go, so goes the family. If your wife isn't going to submit to you, you better step up and be the guy that God has called you to be. The responsibility is on us. If I had to distill down all what the Bible says about what the husband, his role in this relationship is, to be responsible. Men, you are the ones who are responsible. You're the ones who are responsible for the well-being and the flourishing of your wives and your children. Men, you're responsible for the safety and the protection of your family. Men, you are responsible that we're accomplishing the very purposes that God has given to the family. John Piper defines the husband's role as glad assumption of sacrificial responsibility. Glad assumption. We do it gladly. This responsibility has been given to me, and I'm going to do it gladly, and I'm going to sacrifice for the sake of my family. The glad assumption of sacrificial responsibility. And if we take all these three passages together, and we see a picture of a husband who loves his wife. He loves her. That's the word agape. That's the God kind of love. That's the self-sacrificing kind of love. That's the kind of love that puts the needs of others before your own. It's the kind of love that says, I will take the loss so that you can take the gain. That's what agape means. It's the husband who takes responsibility for her spirituality and her emotional and her physical well-being. If a family isn't coming to church, it's the husband's fault. He needs to get up, get his family together, and say, we're going to go and be a part of the community of God, and we're going to celebrate and worship Jesus. Husbands, it's your responsibility to get your family here. If your wife is dragging you along, then you have failed in your sacrificial responsibility to be the kind of husband that she should submit to. It's up to us, men, to be the ones who call forth and lead our families. And then Peter says, we live with our wives in an understanding way. It means we live, in the Greek, it means according to knowledge. It means you don't just have some idea of who your wife is, but you know who your wife is. You have knowledge of who your wife is. In fact, John MacArthur has a great quote. He says, this knowledge that Peter intends here may include any knowledge that would be beneficial to the husband-wife relationship. Again, husbands, this is what you have to have. Knowledge of God's purposes and principles for marriage. Knowledge of the wife's desires, goals, and frustrations. Knowledge of her strengths and her weaknesses in the physical, emotional, and spiritual realms. A husband who lives according to such knowledge will greatly enrich his marriage relationship. Yet such knowledge can only be gained through regular study of God's word and regular, unhurried times of private fellowship together as a husband and a wife. The Bible has a lot more to say to the husbands than he does to the women, because women have been placed in the vulnerable position. That's probably what a lot of people think about this weaker vessel. Because 1 Peter says she's the weaker vessel. She's the one who's been given the vulnerable position. She voluntarily surrenders her life to you to lead her. And so the Bible gives way more instructions to the men to be the kind of guy that calls out and brings out the best in his wife and helps her to grow spiritually, physically, and emotionally. And I can tell you right now, I am not the model husband. Do not look to me to be the model husband. I struggle to be the leader I'm supposed to be. I don't always know her the way that she needs to be known. I do not live up to this part. And so we have to have a sense of humility and continue to allow God to work in our hearts to grow us and to make us more the kind of man that a woman can rightfully submit herself to. A woman is going to have no problem submitting to a man who has her best interests at heart. A woman's going to have no problem submitting to a man who cares for her and nurtures her in such a direction for our life and says, this is what God has called us to do. Let's go do it. And she will be your greatest supporter. She will be your best cheerleader. She will be the one who will give her heart and life to you. She is built for that, and you have been built to lead. We've got to stand up and lead. This church is going to grow, and we have to grow. Because if we're not growing, you know what that means? We're being disobedient to the word of God. We're not seeing people come to saving faith in Jesus Christ. But if this church is going to grow, men have to lead the way. We're going to have to be the ones to stand up and say, we're going to go out. We're going to beat the bushes, and we're going to share our faith, and we're going to invite people to church. If we're going to be faithful in what God's called us to do, men, it's your job. And Hugh is working really hard right now planning some men's ministry Bible studies and small groups, and we're going to do some stuff over this summer because, man, if we don't do it, it will not be done. If we don't do it, it will be not done. So, man, the Bible says so much to us. But the point that I want to make today, again, talked about the wives' role, the men's role, but what does that really mean together? Again, it's mutual, it's equal, and the point that I want to make today is that this difference in our marriages, this difference between men and women, is on purpose. So acknowledge it now. Your wife is different than you. Your husband is different than you, and God meant it to be that way. Because here's what I think is true. I think there's a couple of things that we have to see as overarching applications of this. The first, marriage was not created to make you happy. Marriage was not created to make you happy. What did I say in the very beginning? Marriage is created to accomplish the purposes of God. And so if your marriage is the vehicle or the mechanism that you want to fulfill yourself and, oh, he completes me and, you know, I have value as a person because this guy likes me, girls, don't fall into that trap. You're going to be sorely disappointed because marriage was not created to make you happy. And I think we've all bought into that fairy tale that they lived happily ever after. But God has given us work to do. He's given us a mandate to subdue the whole earth, to bring the whole earth under the lordship of Jesus Christ, to submit to his reign and rule. And he's brought two people together who complement each other with different strengths and different abilities and different perspectives to accomplish that one thing. And so here's the trick. If you want your marriage to get better, quit focusing on how happy you are and focus on, are you accomplishing the work that God has given you to do together? Every time I do premarital counseling, this is exactly what I ask them to do. What is your vision that God has for your marriage to accomplish his purposes? And of course, I go through Genesis, talk about the creation mandate to subdue the earth. I talk about all those things and what that means and say, okay, you, little couple, before you get married, you come to me next week and tell me what is the vision that God has given you guys to fulfill the purposes of God through your relationship. Me and Annie is pretty easy. He's called us to lead and to minister through the church, and she brings her perspective. I bring my perspective. We do it with our whole hearts, and that's the goal of our marriage, that we want to accomplish the very purposes of God through the gifts that he's given us, and we want to do it together. She's the one I want to accomplish the purposes of God with. I don't want to do it with anyone else. I want to do it with her, and so we committed together to accomplish the purposes of God. The reason why we made it 20 years, and there's been ups and there's been downs, but from the very beginning, it has always been about accomplishing the purposes of God. And whenever things got tough, that superseded our happiness. Because here's the deal. None of us are going to be happily married. That's a false idea of what marriage is. But we could be very joyfully married. Because happiness comes and goes. I could be in a bad mood. I could be sick. I could be grumpy. I could be very sinful. I could be all these things. And it could really zap the happiness out of our marriage. But whenever we're committed to accomplishing the purposes of God, we could be very joyfully happy in spite of the ups and downs that come around because we're committed to something larger than ourselves. Figure out what is your vision for your marriage. It's not to make each other happy. I think about the 18th century preacher Jonathan Edwards. Jonathan Edwards changed the whole scope of Christianity in America. He was brilliant, but his wife was probably more brilliant. He would ride around on his horse, and this kind of reminds me of me. He was so absent-minded. He'd ride around on his horse going who knows where, but he'd write little notes to himself about what he was thinking about. He'd pin them to his coat. Then his wife, Sarah, would take all those notes and organize them and put them into a document that actually made sense, right? They had a vision for what they wanted to do for the glory of God together. I think about Josh and Jenna, our very own Harrison and Jenna, who's connected with Josh to go overseas to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ to people. That's the vision for their marriage, and they're doing it together. And that's what's going to keep them together when things get tough, is they have a mutual, you know, understanding of what they want to accomplish. I think about even Donna and Curtis right here, who has a mutual agreement. They want to go every day, and they serve together in the Senior Citizen Center to help this particular demographic to feel encouraged and fed and all of these things. They do it together. And it's something that they can build their marriage on, a mutual expectation that we're going to serve the glory of Christ in whatever way that he gave you. Maybe you have to get to giving, and you go out and make $5 million by selling 10 cows because you're awesome, and your wife helps you that, and you give it all to missions. Whatever you do, do it to the glory of God and see how your marriage is going to get tons better. Marriage wasn't created to make you happy. It was created for you to connect with someone different than you to help you accomplish the purposes of God. And secondly, the fact that that person is different than you is the point. I've said this before too, because God wants us to grow up in Christian faith. He wants us to be mature. He wants us to be compassionate and kind and gentle and long-suffering and forgiving. There's no better place for those attributes to be carved out into your life than marriage. Because you're living with someone who is not like you. They have different opinions. They have different ideas. And you're going to have to learn how to be compassionate and kind. It's in this crucible of marriage that God sanctifies us and makes us holy. So another way I could say this is God has not given you marriage to make you happy, but maybe he's given you marriage to make you holy. Because he wants you to grow up into Christ. He wants you to be fully complete, lacking in nothing. And the way that he can accomplish that is putting you together with someone who's like sandpaper. And they might be rubbing against you all the time, but that's how you get to be beautiful. That's how all the rough edges get rubbed off. And that's how you become useful, is this person is rubbing on you. And she's not rubbing on you to make you mad, but she's rubbing on you because you need to maybe grow up in your forgiveness and your compassion and your kindness. Right? So marriage wasn't given to make you happy, but maybe it was given to make you holy. But the third thing is that marriage was created to be a picture of the gospel. Marriage was created to be a picture of the gospel. Because what is the gospel? Two other things coming together in unity, right? The glory of God coming together with, is it inglorious, inglorious humans in relationship. Two others coming together in a single unity. That's what the gospel is. That's what Paul said in Ephesians. Jesus Christ has come to reconcile all things together, all things in heaven and in earth. He wants to reconcile us to him, and us reconciling to each other is the way that we show the world the gospel. In fact, I was reading an article this week on the Gospel Coalition by a lady named Mary Cassian. She says, essentially, a complementarian is a person who believes that God created male and female to reflect complementary truths about Jesus. That's the bottom line meaning of the word. Complementarians believe that males were designed to shine the spotlight on Christ's relationship to the church and the Lord's relationship to Christ in a way that females cannot. And that females were designed to shine a light on the church's relationship to Christ and Christ's relationship to the Lord God in a way that males cannot. Who we are as male and female is ultimately not about us. It's about testifying to the story of Jesus. We do not get to dictate what manhood or womanhood is about. God does, because he's our creator. So women, this is an awesome and wonderful opportunity to show the beauty of Jesus as you surrender yourself to your husband. You show people what it's like to submit to a God who loves you and wants to take care of you. And men, what a wonderful and awesome opportunity that you have to show a testimony of a loving God who cares for his creation, who wants to nurture it and create it. We, being married, are a picture of the gospel, and it matters. It matters terribly. It matters tremendously. And as we begin to understand a bigger purpose for our marriage, more than just being happy, then we have a common goal to glorify Christ with our gifts and with our abilities, and we begin to show the beauty of the gospel in coming together in a redeeming unity. And I know there's people here who are not married, and I understand that. And sometimes God, in his providence, again, he gets to decide, gives people the gift of singleness, and sometimes he gives you the gift of, hey, you just need to wait a while. I don't know. And I don't want to diminish your role, because you have a wonderful opportunity to show the goodness of God through your life as well. But those who are married, this is critical for you guys. It's not about you. It's about Jesus. It's not about your happiness. It's about your fulfillment and your wholeness and your completeness. God is accomplishing something in you that you never thought was possible because he's doing it in these relationships that help us to grow into the image of Jesus. And I think there's nothing we can do better than to stand up and say, I'm going to fight for this thing because Jesus has fought for me. While I was a sinner, Christ died for me. How can I stand up and say, I won't be forgiving? I won't be forbearing. I won't be loving. And then come on the other side and say, Jesus, forgive me and forbear with me and be loving to me. Marriage matters. And let's do what we can to fulfill the role that God has given us. And we want to offer these things. Not only are we doing men's Bible studies this summer, we're going to do some women's Bible studies this summer. And there's unique things to being a woman and being a man that we can work out together as we then go back into our marriages and live it out. But First, what is your vision that your marriage is to accomplish before God? Secondly, how is your marriage a testimony to the gospel, Jesus Christ? When those two things are straight, everything else will fall into place. Let me pray as Hugh comes up. Father God, thank you for your word, and thank you for helping us understand the harmony and the balance that you created into this world. And Father, help us to understand that that was all destroyed because of our sin. Marriage isn't bad because you've called the wives to submit. Marriage is bad because husbands are sinful and wives are sinful. Father, I pray that you help me to understand the sinfulness of my own heart, to repent and to grow in faith and surrender to your will, so our marriage can stand as a testimony to the gospel. Father, I pray for marriages right now that are in conflict. Father, we know that's a reality that many are facing, and Father, we know that sometimes it can seem daunting and it can seem overwhelming to think about restoration, but Father, we know you're the one who brings dead things to life. You can bring dead marriages to life as well. I know many here in this room have been hurt by marriage, and I just do pray that you give them forgiveness and healing in their heart, not to be bitter and to live with grace. Father, we know that only comes from you as well. And we just pray that in whatever situation we find ourselves, that we know that you are our source of comfort and peace and harmony, and that you're the one who can hold us and strengthen us, and you seal us by your Spirit, preserving us for our eternal reward. And Father, we know that in that journey there's going to be a lot of pain, but we know that you can be our comforter, and we pray for all that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's praise our God as we exit this morning.
Be the glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son. He yielded his life, an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. No godless offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receive. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Taught us great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our victory when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. great things he has done.
God bless you all. Thank you. You're dismissed. Hope to see you next week.